What's up, everybody? I wanted to take a minute before the video started to talk about what's going on in our world today. The injustices that Black Americans face on a daily basis in our country is honestly despicable, and I want to encourage every single one of you to support the Black Lives Matter movement in any way that you can, whether that's going out to protests or donating or just any way that you can help, signing those petitions, however you can help, please do so. I'm gonna link some resources down below in the description so that you all can help with that as well. And this is also for my non-Black friends, obviously, that goes without saying. So just educate yourself, educate those in your life. If you see people acting out and acting against what the Black Lives Matter movement stands for, then please step in and say something. Use your white privilege for good. Also, just make sure, like I said, that you donate if you can, that you come out to the protests if you can. Johnny and I just went to one last night. We're planning on going to more soon. Please just show up and show out and let the world know that the way that Black Americans have been treated for numerous years stops now. Like, there's going to be no more of it. So please also stay safe. I would hate if anything happened to anyone else, and I honestly just want you all to stay safe. And also remember that silence is violence. Also, I'm going to be posting this intro on all of my videos until further notice. Thank you all for watching my video. Thank you all for supporting the Black Lives Matter movement. And without further ado, let's hop on into this week's video. My name is Brandon and welcome back to my channel. Today I am doing part 7 of my Stonewall Reader reading vlog. It's still late, but you know, better late than never. Still catching up, and I'm on track to release these videos before the last day in June. So it's technically still during Pride Month. So thanks for staying true and watching these videos despite how late they are. What I'm gonna try to do today is make a one take video. We'll see how that comes out, but I don't want to have to edit this because I need to read the rest of these, because I've got what, like 9 more excerpts that I need to read. So need to hop on that as soon as possible because Johnny has a friend over today, so I'm not gonna be getting much reading done. And then he has family coming later, and then I think I've got to visit my dad. He's visiting his mom in South Carolina, so I think I'm gonna have to go visit him because he wants me to bleach his hair and then dye it gray, because I've been doing that myself. So we'll see what happens, but I don't know of any other great times that I'm gonna be able to read before the end of June, so I really want to finish this. So I'm gonna try and speed through this as much as possible. But the first excerpt that I read was from Reverend Troy D. Perry, and this was from The Lord is My Shepherd, and He Knows I'm Gay. And I just thought that was so great. He was the pastor of the first Christian denomination to affirm the lives of LGBTQ people, which I love that. So let's see. There was one thing that I thought was interesting and funny when they were doing a parade in Los Angeles to kind of mimic the New York City parade that was going on for Gay Pride. It was a very last minute thing in Los Angeles because they didn't get the AOK yet. And so when they finally did get the AOK, they pulled it all together and they made it happen. But there was this one like conservative group of gays that said, "Homosexuals for Ronald Reagan," like on a sign. And it said, "I heard one woman spectator on the sidewalk say, I can forgive them for being homosexuals, but not for being for Ronald Reagan." I just thought that was really funny. And it seemed like the main focus of this parade in Los Angeles was to break down stereotypes that have been placed on queer people. A lot of the signs were, "We're not this, we're this, we're not this, we're this," which I just thought was super interesting. It's not really like that anymore, obviously, but
it's apparent that it needed to be that in the beginning to break down these people's assumptions on what queer identities were. So I just thought that was really interesting as well. And then he decided to do, like, because he is a priest, he decided to do like a prayer vigil. He decided to do a prayer vigil and a fast. And while he was doing that, a lot of people came and joined him, which was great. But then the police kept coming and telling him that he was breaking the law, And he was like, I don't understand how I'm breaking the law. Like, can you tell me? And they wouldn't tell him. They came like 6 or 7 times before they finally arrested him and a group of other people. I think it was really him and like 2 lesbian women. And so they arrested them, took them to jail. Once they were in jail, they were allowed to be released. And the priest, the reverend, was like, no, I'd rather stay here because you guys have been coming up to me 6 or 7 times tonight, and you've already got me here now. I'm not trying to come back down here because I know you're just going to keep harassing me and trying to arrest me. So I'd rather just stay here. So they let him stay there. It was crazy because when the press came in, the police officers were super kind to the press, but they wouldn't answer any of the reverend's questions whenever the reverend had questions. So I thought that was bullshit, obviously. So one of the police officers talked to this man, because the reverend, because he was like, I've never talked to a gay person before. And I just thought that was interesting that back then too, like, people were trying to understand. And yeah, they may not have been the best people in the world, but at least some people were actually trying to understand queer culture and the queer community. And then in the jail cell, he said, the reverend said that he woke up and there were these cries coming from a few cells over, and it was this trans woman who was being beaten by the other guys that were in there. And I just thought it was really sad. However, the reverend misgenders this woman and calls her him and his and he. And obviously, like, during that time, they didn't really know the pronouns as well. However, it was interesting to note that he did it so many times and then continues to do it later in the passage as well. And then it says, the police officers were using different numbers during like the mugshot process and using different names for the reverend. And so he says, say, this is a big mistake. This is the wrong name and the wrong booking number. They just laughed and said, oh, that's okay. Don't worry. It doesn't make any difference. And I'm like, something seems sketchy here. So one attorney appointed by the state came in to talk to the reverend, and he was like, you just need to pay your bail, blah, 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 blah. And the reverend's like, I'm not going to pay my bail. Like, I'm not doing that because I did nothing wrong. And, you know, it was staying steadfast in what he had to say. And then that attorney left. And then the second court-appointed attorney came in and was like, you know, you're on the Los Angeles Times. You're on the second page. Like, this is crazy. This is amazing. You should be celebrating. And the judge feels horrible. And he feels like he's being made to look like an idiot because of these police officers. And they really shouldn't have done this. So he wants to get you out of here as soon as possible. And I was like, period, like, yes, we love when justice is done right. So then the reverend was released and his family was there, and they all gave him a standing ovation when he walked in the courtroom. And it was a beautiful thing, and I'm glad that it worked out the way that it did. Now on to the second excerpt that I read from Perry Brass, and it's called We Did It. And this was just talking about the first like Pride March and how they made it happen. And what I thought was interesting about this excerpt was that it was all about the gay men, and it doesn't really talk about any other identity in the LGBTQ+ community. And I was like, what, that's like really strange. Like, why is that? And one of the slogans that they would sing during the march was, sing it loud, sing it clear, gay is proud, gay is here. I just love that. And if your mother could only see you now, one old man on a sidewalk in the village shouted. If your mother could only see you now, one old man on a sidewalk in the village shouted. Well, she certainly could if she tried hard enough, and it's about time she did, because it's about time 14 million, give or take a few million, according to Kinsey, people in America stopped being bachelors or single Americans and started being gay women and men. And I just thought that was interesting to be like, yes, like, we're here, like, come out, wherever you are. You know, and just trying to pull people who are still in the closet to come out and know that that's okay. I thought it was funny too, because it was like this whole week leading up to the Gay Pride Parade was Gay Pride Week, and it said whether you were gay, straight, or ambidextrous. I just thought that was funny the way that he worded that, rather than bisexual or pansexual or anything like that. Obviously, it was just ambidextrous, whether you use both hands. I just thought that was funny. The next excerpt that I read was from Jeanne Cordova. And this is from When We Were Outlaws. And a few different things were, as a lesbian, she was talking about how during the pride parades, it was very focused on the gay men, and the lesbians were kind of taking action, and they were like, we need to carry our own banner, we need to do this, because in a lot of court cases, children were being taken away from their lesbian or bisexual mothers because they were seen as unfit to raise these children. And so they were really focusing on getting these basic rights for these lesbian and bisexual women. And it says, a banner carried by an elderly straight-looking woman walking alone read, heterosexuals for homosexual freedom. I wanted to salute this woman. Someday, perhaps even in my own lifetime, gays will be free, I told myself. And I just thought that was so sweet, like that old woman just walking with her banner talking about, you know, gay pride should exist and the heterosexuals support the homosexuals. And I just love that so much. Like, that was so sweet. It made me tear up a little bit. but then you see the cops treating people in the parade like shit. And then it's like this big like juxtaposition of like, wow, that's a really sweet moment. And then the next paragraph talks about, you know, the brutality and the just mess that these cops were during this time. And I wrote, still going on today in 2020, because it said, when I was social working in South Central 3 years after the Watts Rebellion of 65, I'd seen many armed young men and learned that the FBI's counterintelligence program was all over the black activist community. The feds wanted nothing more than to hunt down every member of the so-called insurrectionist Black Panthers, who they believed sought the violence to overthrow white America. And I was like, still going on today. Like, obviously, like, the cops are still trying to subvert our world to white supremacy, and it's sickening, honestly. And then there was a straight man who gets out of his car while these lesbians are walking across the street, and he screams, the only good fag is a dead fag, get the fuck out of the way. And like, that kind of hit home too, because like, I've heard that before, like in my hometown, like I've heard that saying before. And like, it's just, it sucks that that still goes on. But she handles it really well. And she calls the local drag queens to come on over, and she's like, it says, I pointed toward my Aryan, which I thought was funny that she called him an Aryan. Go kiss him, get him back into his car so our people can cross the intersection. And it says, the gaggle of queens descended upon the tall, now speechless blonde. One stroked his arm, another pinched his butt. The muscled, straight guy shrank from the queens. The only safe place was in his car. Quickly, he jumped back in, slammed the door, raised the window, and locked himself in. Drag phobia had saved the day. And I said, it's definitely not right to sexually assault someone. Obviously, they were like grabbing his ass, touching on him, kissing at him, things like that, which, you know, is problematic. And I just put, but did he deserve it? Like, at what point are, you know, like, I don't know. Like, he was being a dick and he was threatening violence. So, like, it was that better than them whooping his ass to get him back in the car? Like, I don't understand what would have been better, but I was just like, you know, that sucks that they had to go to that length to get him back in his car, but he should have stayed in to begin with, period. And then they made a plan where there were gonna be two gay couples, two like gay men, two lesbians, and then a straight couple that kind of outed themselves as using what the court calls sodomy and oral copulation, which oral copulation makes me laugh so hard. Like, why is it called oral copulation? Like, that's just so funny to me. Anyway, I was like laughing out loud when I read that part. But they admitted to that, and it's to show, like, yes, straight people do this too. Gay people do this, yes, obviously. And it's okay. Like, it's not bad that they're doing what they want to do sexually. Like, that's not a problem. And they used their coming out and telling people that they did this publicly to raise awareness for those lesbian mothers and those bisexual mothers who were seen as unfit to raise their children. So I thought that was really great as well. And next we have Marsha P. Johnson again, and this is her interview with Alan Young, and this is called Rapping with a Street Transvestite Revolutionary. And I'm so glad that I got to hear more from Marsha P. Johnson. Like I said, there was already an interview with her and someone else who I can't remember right now off the top of my head, that I did in a previous video where she didn't really talk much and I wanted more from her. Bitch, we get it here, okay? So it talked a lot about STAR, which was the Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries, which is the group her and Sylvia Rivera started together. And it was really interesting reading about all of this stuff. She talked about how, as a woman of the night, Marsha P. Johnson faced a lot of violence and a lot of adversity from straight men and from police officers and from other trans individuals and other gay men too, which was crazy. So it was interesting to hear her viewpoint on all of that. And a lot of times in the jails, they would keep the trans women together, which I thought was really interesting. And then the trans women would get in fights with each other in the jail, which I thought was also interesting. And it says that the straight prisoners were a little better to them than the other trans prisoners were, which I thought was interesting. And they said, obviously not all the time, but there were sometimes, most of the time, when they were treated like women and the men wouldn't mess with them, which I thought was really cool. And I like this quote. It says, STAR is a very revolutionary group. We believe in picking up the gun, starting a revolution if necessary. So I thought that was really interesting as well. Marsha also talked about the activism that she was doing in the queer community at the time and how they were planning on getting trans women who couldn't produce bail to get themselves out of jail. Like, they were raising money for that. They were having dances, they were having different events that were raising money to get these women out of jail, which I thought was really great as well. And talks about how the gay sisters, meaning the lesbians, were a lot better toward the trans individuals than the gay men were. And I just thought, like, I didn't really understand it. And Marsha outlines it here and says, of course I can understand why. A lot of gay brothers don't like women, and transvestites remind you of women. A lot of the gay brothers don't feel too close to women. They'd rather be near men. That's how come they're gay. And when they see a transvestite coming, she reminds them of a woman automatically, and they don't want to get too close or too friendly with her. And I was just like, really? Like, for me, it's the opposite. Like, even gay guys, like, I don't have really any gay guy friends except Johnny. Like, that's pretty much it. But I have women friends, straight, bi, queer, gay, lesbian friends. So it's just, and trans women. But I don't really have a lot of guy friends. So I just thought that was interesting that back then they were like very focused on just the guys, which I was like, okay. I thought it was interesting too, where Marsha talks about having her husband, and she was still working as a prostitute, while her husband, you know, and her were married. And he didn't want her hanging out with the other trans individuals because he wanted her to be part of his world, the straight world. And it says, he wanted me to go in the straight world, like straight bars and stuff like that. And I was like, that had to be hard for her to, you know, balance, you know, where she was in life and who she loved versus where her heart is in this activism of trans individuals. And she talks about how trans individuals are the only people who are ever going to stand up for trans individuals. And I'm so glad that that's not true now. Like a lot of people are standing up for trans individuals and for their right to be themselves, like basic human dignity. Like, anyway, so I'm so glad that people are finally standing up for them and you know, letting them know that they're valid and they're welcome in our society. And then she also goes into a lot of different like outlinings of what a drag queen is, what a transvestite is, and what a transsexual is. Obviously, the two terms that are used in the latter part of those three aren't used anymore, so don't use those. But it was so interesting to see what her breakdown of it was back then and to know obviously what it is now. And then at the end she talks about having mace just in case anyone wants to try her, and the interviewer goes, did you ever have to use it? And she goes, not yet, but I'm patient. And I'm like, period. Like, she's ready. Like, she's like, I'm just waiting for the right one to try. And I just love that. And then the last excerpt that I read was by Kiyoshi Kurumaya, and this talks about being a Japanese American, born in a Japanese American internment camp, and so he spoke out a lot, not just about the gay rights movement, but about the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement. One thing that I thought was funny was mentioned Frank Kameny, which, like I said before, like, not the biggest fan of what he had to say in this book. However, like, I've got another book about him that I kind of want to read to see if there's more about him. But I don't really like him here either. Like, he's only considering the gay man. And he's telling all of these people who showed up for this protest that they have to wear their suit and tie. They have to look professional, which I get for the gay men. But why are women wearing it too? And then they weren't allowed to take it off because you have to look professional because the world has to know that we're normal. Which, again, yes, they should be able to accept queer people for being queer without them having to dress up and do this like whole like scene. However, during that time, obviously people needed to see that they were normal people. So it was just, I wish there would have been a better way for our lesbian and trans brothers and sisters during that time to show that they were a part of the community. Like, why is it so focused on the gay men? So that is it for today's video. If you liked it, please give it a big thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And also, hit that post notification bell so you are notified every time that I post a new video. My name is Brandon. I will see you all next time. Bye.